Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our NHB curatorial talk, NHB Academy dialogue session on a history of the museum of the future in 10 objects. We are privileged to have with us today Dr. Chris Michaels with us, and he'll be sharing on the top 10 things that will matter most as the British Museum creates the first digital museum of the world. To begin today's proceedings, I would like to invite Director of NHB Academy, Ms. Thangamma Kadikesu, to introduce Dr. Michaels. Ms. Thangam, please.
Hello, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for coming to this very interesting talk this afternoon by Dr. Chris Michaels. But before that, I would like to also say that we are very happy that this month we have been having a bumper crop of very good speakers, very evident speakers from around the world. And for those of you who attended 2 weeks ago, we had a very interesting talk by Ms. Nurit Shiloh Cohen, who is the Emeritus Curator at Large from the Israel Museum. And today we have an equally distinguished speaker with us today to share his ideas on what he is embarking on as a personal journey in transforming the British Museum into the museum of and for the world. Okay, before I hand over the mic, it's my pleasure to do a short introduction to Dr. Michaels. He's currently the head of digital and publishing at the British Museum. He's also a board director of the British Museum Company Limited, the museum's commercial trading subsidiary, and a member of the British Museum Management Group and Digital Advisory Group. Besides his very exciting work at the museum, he also has time to be one of the board directors, or the trustees rather, of Kazoom, a theatre company where he plays an advisory role to the artistic director on integrating digital into their creative process and output. And closer to Singapore, Dr. Michaels is also a member of our National Heritage Board's Digital Engagement Advisory Committee. And that's one of the reasons why we cornered him and asked him to give us the talk today. And prior to his current post at the British Museum, Dr. Michaels was the Chief Executive Officer of Mindshapes, an award-winning children's education mobile startup. He was also Senior Vice President at international media company Coron, a digital publisher at HarperCollins, and actually he started his professional life in advertising. Dr. Michael holds a Bachelor of Arts degree in English from the University College London and has a PhD in American Literature from the University of Bristol. Okay, without further ado, I think we are all waiting to hear the exciting talk by Dr. Michaels, and it's my pleasure to now invite Dr. Michaels.
Hi, so thank you for that very kind introduction. Before I start with the presentation in general, I'd just like to say a big note of thanks to the National Heritage Board for inviting me to do this today and for inviting me to participate in your digital resource panel. I think generally, this is an incredibly exciting time to be engaged in around digital in museums. And so what I'm going to do today is to tell you the story of what I'm doing at the British Museum and how I'm going on that journey. To do that, I'm going to use a method that the British Museum does when it tells stories to the world. I think one of the museum sector's great virtues is we tell stories about the history of mankind and about the art that mankind has produced. We have an amazing capability to tell that story through the objects that we conserve, we preserve, and which we display to the world. So I'm going to use this story as a chance to tell you about 10 objects which have inspired me as we're starting to go on our journey around digital strategy at the museum. Through that, I'm going to tell you the story of kind of how we're going towards the future, and then I'd love to engage in a dialogue with you all afterwards about how the things that can really change the way museums work through digital can be applied into what you guys are doing over here. So, introduction. I think the important thing to say is that the museum of the future, the museum that fully embraces digital, will only fully emerge when we can really learn lessons from the past. Today I'm going to tell you a story about what the museum is doing in digital and how we're going to get to it. I'm going to tell it through objects. And echo. And I said, we're going to tell that story through the objects that have inspired me and helped to go on that journey. We're going to... This is a little bit too echoey. We're going to tell that story starting a long, long time ago with one of the original objects in the British Museum's collection. So, we're going to start off by talking about the vision that I have for digital and how I've got to it. The three parts of that we're going to talk about starts 3,500 years BC. So, this is Gebeline Man. He's one of the primary objects at the heart of the British Museum's collection. sometime around 3,500 years BC, so about over 5,500 years ago, this guy, who we like to call Ginger, he had red hair, died and was put out in the desert. He's one of the earliest examples and part of a collection that we have of the museum of natural mummification. So by simply by putting his dead body out in the desert, the minerals in the sand, the combination with the sun, the desert sun, preserved his body forevermore. I think if I think about what a museum can be, it's that fundamental role of telling that universal story about life and death, the whole history of mankind that comes from that. And Gebelein Man is an incredible symbol of that. I think we as museums have to recognize the strength of the cultural history that we talk about and have to be incredibly confident with that. But that confidence can come from the objects at the core of our collection. And for me, as I think about the British Museum, people like Ginger, those stories that come from people like Ginger and their lives and deaths, incredible way to have access into understanding what the value can be for us of what digital can mean. Object number two, the flood tablet. One of the core parts of the British Museum's collection is a set of objects from ancient Iraq, done from about 750, 650 BC. In ancient Iraq, there was a king called Ashurbanipal, who styled himself in a very modest fashion, the king of the world. He saw that one of his great tasks in life would be to collate all of the knowledge of mankind into one place, and so he formed what is called the Ashurbanipal Library. What is he did? He sent his scribes out with pieces of clay out into the world to write down on those clay tablets the whole of the history of the knowledge of mankind. He gathered those things together in one building, and through that, through 32,000-ish tablets that were collated there, he told the whole of the story of mankind to all of mankind. I think as I look at that, that's inspiration in two senses. One is, it's inspiration that that's kind of what the British Museum some 2,000 years later would try and do for itself. It would try and become a place where the whole history of mankind was told to all of mankind. I think if I look at it, the next phase of that, it's now what people who are creating the digital universe we live in are also trying to do. Actually, if you think about Google, what are they except an attempt to gather all of the knowledge and history of mankind into one service where all of that knowledge gets aggregated together? So I think by thinking about stuff like this, you can see a path back through history so that the objects of the past and how they connect absolutely to what takes place today. And again, as we start to talk about what makes digital meaningful, it's thinking about what it really means for the objects in our collections and how the stories that those objects tell become relevant to the audiences today. The second part that's so relevant about that is some of the knowledge that was contained on these tablets. In about 1852, one of the curators first working on these in the museum was decoding cuneiform, one of the earliest forms of written language, and realized that the story told on one of those tablets was a story about Noah and his ark. Now, in Christian history, that story is a story told as part of the narrative continuity of the history of the world told in the Bible. But this was a different version of that story. So different people in a different part of the world telling that story for themselves in their own language. This was very exciting in 1852. No one had ever seen this version of history before. And the guy got so excited that he legendarily took off all his clothes and ran through the museum screaming about what he discovered. That's incredibly important to understand what the British Museum is, because it's an opportunity where actually we can see ourselves as discovering ways different cultures are connected together. I think that kind of behavior is incredibly important as we think about Singapore and what it can mean here. Singapore is a place in the modern world which connects different global cultures together, a meeting place for the world. And I think that's a shared heritage and a shared value between the British Museum and Singapore, which I think can help shape some of the relationship we have together in the future. Third part, as I think about what the British Museum means for digital, is this entry ticket. So the British Museum opened in the 1750s, and it opened with a great founding vision of being this place where the whole world could come together and experience the history of the whole world all in one place. The thing is, in 1750s, that was not possible. The whole world could not come into one place and experience the history of the whole world. So what that meant in reality was that 5,000 people per year could come through the door. They'd write a letter in advance. They'd get a ticket through the post, they'd come up, they'd hand it to the housekeeper, Mary Bygrave, and she would lead them on a tour of Hans Sloane's phenomenal collection of 61,000 things that he'd collected over his life. That was not the whole world, but the dream was always of the whole world. And so, as I've started to think about what digital can mean for the museum, it always means going back to that founding goal and thinking, actually, can we become the way that the whole world can start to understand what we do? And that's how it's led me to the vision that I have of what the British Museum in digital must be trying to achieve. Because as I see it and understand it, my vision for the British Museum is that digital is the opportunity to fulfil our founding goals. We're at a unique moment in the history of mankind, where sometime in the next 20 years, the whole of mankind will become connected to the internet. Sometime in the next 20 years. At that point, institutions such as ours, institutions such as yours, get the opportunity to speak to the whole world for the first time through one or multiple digital channels. That's never been possible before. Even 5 years ago, it was impossible to think beyond the context of here is a website that speaks to some of the world, and here is a museum which, beyond the people who walk through the doors, it cannot be spoken to through the digital channels. As we create the digital museum of the future, it has to start from that great goal of being able to talk to everybody about the history of mankind. And so that's where we begin. I'm starting on a journey that takes place in three stages, and I start today where Neil McGregor, our current director, has done an amazing job of building the museum to a point where 6.8 million people came to the museum last year. Phenomenal number of people in a relatively small physical space. 15 million people used our websites. Another 30 million people connect to us through books, through TV programs, through the other type of media we create. That number will be higher this year because we are very fortunate that Fox set Night at the Museum 3 in the British Museum. Now, it's not a great representation of the museum because it has dinosaurs in it, and we don't have any dinosaurs, but it brings people into contact with some of what we do. My vision, though, is simply to get to that point in 2030 where I can tell stories to the whole world, and we start on a journey in the next 5 years to find out how to do that. So, what's our 2020 challenge? So, as I think about this, there's three things we really have to do as an organization to really learn how to talk to the world at full scale. One is to massively increase our reach. I said today we reach about 50 million people through the variety of the people who come, the media we create, and the advocacy we do online. Simply put, we have to double that. We have to triple that. And so by 2020, my goal is to reach 250 million people a year with the content that we put out into the world. That's going to mean thinking very differently about what that type of content is and how we work with our audience to create it, and I'll talk more about that later. Two is thinking then about relationships. As we start to talk to more and more people, we need to understand more and more about the audience that comes into connection with us. One of the things that struck me as I came into the museum sector from the outside was actually comparatively how little the museum sector knows about its audience. Whilst we can do fantastic surveys and we can do amazing work understanding that audience occasionally, in real time, as I would if I was running some of the apps I ran before, I know very little about who's walking through my museum, what are they doing, what are the objects they're looking at right now, how does it connect to what people are looking at on my websites, how does it connect to what books they buy because of the websites they look at and the things they look at in the museum. The connections between things are very loose. And so for me, tightening those connections is a fundamental part of my job. Simply, I want to build databases of relations to audience that go from about a million and a half people now, again, to tens of millions of people. That means thinking about social media and email databases and those other kind of direct mail channels all as one thing, because we have to think about that audience in total and build our relationships to them very strongly. Now, the third part is the hard part, is that I need to make more money for the British Museum. We are a partially government-funded institution. About 35%, 40% of our funding comes from government. And in a very changing economic climate, we can only expect that that will decrease over time. So the pressure that I want to take for myself is to say, I can make more money for you, and to find out sensible and smart ways to do that. Partly that comes back to the relationships piece, and again, I'll speak about this, is that the core for us is finding out what people want to do and can do in relation to the museum and when it's the appropriate time to sell them things. I believe as a result of that, I can sell more tickets for exhibitions than we do now. I can sell more memberships to the museum than we do now. I can appropriately help people to buy more things through e-commerce. I can market to them so they go into our shops in different ways. And if and where appropriate, I can create commercial digital products, apps, other types of commercial content that will sell to people. And the result of that is, I said, I want to make significantly more money than I do now from that. The museum traditionally is monetized through tickets and through selling books. We need to do more things than that to move forward into the future. How are we going to do this then? Well, again, I think there's three core things we have to put at the heart of the museum of the future that will take us forward. The first of those is recognizing the power of mobile. Again, the museum of 5 years ago was divided between two things. One was an audience that looked at our websites primarily on laptops or desktop computers. Two was an audience that came to the museum and didn't necessarily use their phones whilst we were there. Simply put, I think smartphones are transforming the way people have their museum experience. And I can see that in both the statistics I have from my websites, and I can see that in what I see people are doing when they're in the museum. Within 2 years, even if I didn't change anything, mobile phones would be the primary way in which people access British Museum websites. That will happen whether I do anything or not. But I think if I take it very seriously and put mobile at the heart of my digital product strategy, I can change the way people plan their visit, and I can change what they do during their visit, so that mobile experience becomes continuous throughout their journey with us. Alongside mobile has to sit social media. Nothing has transformed the world possibly more than social in the last 10 years. The very notion, when I was working in advertising in 2006, when Facebook first launched in the UK, that Facebook could have 1.4 billion users by this point in time would have been laughable. The very notion that entire industries, advertising, television, different types of media would be completely turned on their head by people connecting to each other in real time, by consuming content in a personalized feed, again, unthinkable at that stage. But we have seen that change. At the same time, I think we're starting to see that change in museums. People are starting ever more to engage through social into their museum experience, and I think it's incredibly important that museums take seriously the value that that can bring to the visitor's experience with us, and think how it sits at the heart of what we do. Alongside mobile and social may actually be the most important thing, which is the role of data. I mean, again, if I look back, museums have understood relatively little about what their audience does in relationship to them. But that's the same journey the whole world is on right now. That journey is called the journey to big data. And if I look back at the amount of data a museum generated 10 years ago, very, very small. The whole of my ticketing database is 10 megabytes in size for 10 years worth of data. That means we don't know very much about what people have been doing in relationship to us. But as we enable Wi-Fi-based services, as we see people using more and more social media with us, as we launch ever more diverse array of digital products, we will start to see more and more data sets come in. We'll start to see that increasingly happen in real time, and we will need to understand what that means. Because if we don't, we will continue to do what I think we've all done historically, which is to kind of put lots of resource into replicating things that are happening elsewhere in institutions. Marketing teams that have to duplicate what happens in curatorial teams, that have to duplicate what happens in interpretive teams, because your systems aren't built and created in ways where that information can be shared in really effective ways internally, but then makes it difficult to go externally and share that data beyond that. And so bringing the insight and analysis that helps you understand really what people are doing, I think is a huge change for us all to go through. So where are we starting from? I don't know much about museums because I've only worked in one for a year. And I have small children, so I haven't been to any for a long time. But if I look at what a museum is, of course the collection and its meaning is the heart of what a museum is. But on top of that, actually what you're doing is running a very diverse range of different marketing and commercial services. So you've got marketing initiatives, the social media profiles you run, the websites you run, the email campaigns you do, those different kind of above-the-line marketing activities that support that. You're running different forms of commerce. The British Museum runs 5 retail shops, which each have a differentiated offer. We run a box office that enables you to buy tickets on the phone, on web, and walk up. We run e-commerce stores. We make content. We work in the broadcasting market. We work in publishing, producing a phenomenal variety and diversity and depth of content each year. We run collection search, so that ability to access different forms of academic content. We generate huge amounts of research. We have anything up to 130 different research projects running simultaneously in the museum, each of them generating content that goes out in lots of different forms out into the universe. We run in-gallery media. We have screens in about 30% of our galleries. We run mobile tours. We do trails. We do immense amounts. We do teaching resources, a huge amount of stuff that goes out. We then run a lot of services. We run member services who have to keep 100,000 members, many with a great sense of entitlement about their relationship to the museum, very happy in their time they spend with us. We run events, both corporate events, institutional events, educational events. We run educational programs for children under the age of 11, for teenagers, for foreign language visitors. We then run visitor services and customer services. That's a huge amount of things for any smallish organization to run. We only have 500 permanent members of staff at the British Museum, and they have to run all of these things between us, and 100 of those staff are curators who don't do any of those things. So a very small number of people have to do an awful lot. The challenge at the moment is if I took one member of our audience And let's say that member of our audience was looking at our collection search system. If I could find out who they were when they were using that system, I would not be able to identify if they were also someone who was signed up to our email accounts, who liked us on Facebook, who watched our TV programs, who read our books, who went on one of our mobile tours. That makes it incredibly hard to manage the relationship with that person, because each time they come to us, it's almost like they're coming to us for the first time. Now, the challenge of that is with the British Museum, actually, there are people who come four times a week. We don't know what happens and what changes between each of those visits. So thinking of that audience as one audience who can have a very long and complex journey with us is something we need to learn how to do, and something we need to join up to bring that audience together. What it means simply is the individual teams who manage each of those spaces waste a lot of resource trying to create an experience that's always the first time for every user. So we have to begin by creating a system and a capability to understand what people really, really do with us. So where are we going with this? The technical word, and I find it a slightly pretentious term, but it's technically correct, is we're creating an omni-channel experience. That's a word that you'll see out there if you go to digital media conferences talking about what's happening in retail, what's happening with corporate brands. Simply, it means that you're creating an experience whereby if someone comes through one media channel or one contact point, you can trace and offer them the right content at the right time wherever they are. That's a big shift for us as an organization. It's a big shift for any organization, because typically the way you service those different needs across different spaces are done by different teams in different silos, on different systems, with different needs at different times. As we work towards that omnichannel process, we have to both create systems and technologies that enable that, but also workflows and processes that enable us to get into that space where we can actually genuinely understand what people are doing. Each harness the power of that technology at a point where it's relevant to us and to our audience, but see that a whole customer has a whole life cycle with us. Simply, when a visitor comes to the British Museum, they don't care if they're interacting with our visitor services team, our retail services team, our marketing team, or anyone else. They are interacting with the British Museum. And so we have to represent a single unified face to the world through the work that we do. And by doing that, yes, it will take time and it will take complexity to get there, but it will actually save amazing amounts of time once we've got to that point. And I think that's a valid journey for any museum to take. It's not just a single thing that the British Museum can uniquely do. It's something every and all museums should try and do. And I think it's an interesting challenge for the NHB, because you're not talking about a single museum, you're talking about across museums. But the ability to kind of optimize the use of those resources across different channels. Again, amazing opportunity to bring your audiences together. So that the audience that goes to the Philatelic Museum, you can tell if they're the same people who go to the Asian Civilizations Museum. That's an incredibly powerful thing to be able to do. And as you form a broader part of the tourism industry within the country, again, you're forming part of a bigger picture. One of the interesting challenges for us, once we've integrated with that, is to integrate more broadly into the tourism market that sits in the UK. Because tourism is also going through this process. Our National Tourist Board deeply wants to understand what's the journey of a user throughout their tourism experience in the UK. So getting your own house in order and bringing that data set together for yourself will enable you to link up into then what other people are doing. The simple benefit of that will be more visitors. And that's what we want, is more visitors having a better time with us and then coming back. And from that, all good things will follow. So that's the core vision that we're trying to achieve. My goal is I'm going to achieve all of that within 5 years. I start on that process now. So over the last 6 months, so I first met the NHB in June last year. Very shortly after that, I started a big reorganization process that I just finished last week, putting a new team in place to go and deliver this work on behalf of the museum. As any of you know, changing things in public sector environments has its bureaucratic problems. I don't think that's different in any part of the world. It's certainly not different in the UK. So now we're doing it, we start on the real work that's going to help bring us to the future. This is the phase which I call learning to speak, because in a way we have to start learning a lot of these lessons again from the beginning, again always taking inspiration from the past. So my inspiration here starts with probably the British Museum's most famous ever project, which is A History of the World in 100 Objects. So this to me is a great example that A, storytelling matters, but B, the output of that storytelling might have its most potent effect in the place you least expect. The History of the World of 100 Objects was conceived as a radio show. famously, Neil McGregor, our director, was having lunch with the director general of the BBC. The director general said to him, can you do a show that tells the history of mankind in 10 objects? And Neil said, well, no, that's not very many. And so over the wine was flowing, the lunch progressed, they went to 20 objects, and they went to 50 objects, and eventually they landed at 100 objects. 5 years later, this amazing program emerged. And so this was really an incredible example of multi-platform storytelling. Now, no one would have called it multi-platform storytelling at the time. Neil would never use the word multi-platform, and I'm grateful that he wouldn't. But what it did was it took a story and told it in different media in different ways. First of all, a radio show, a 100-part radio show, broadcast on Radio 4, the primary adult narrative radio station in the UK, over 100 weeks. That's 2 years' worth of radio content. Incredible labour to do that. But they didn't stop there. They also published an 800-page book with Penguin, multi-million selling book that sold right around the world. They didn't stop there. They also created an exhibition in the museum that wasn't a standalone exhibition. It wasn't put off in one of our temporary exhibition spaces. It was an exhibition that took place throughout the collection. And it brought both hundreds of thousands of new people through the door of the museum. It also, possibly for the first time ever in 250 years, told a very coherent story about what the museum is and told it all in one go. The interesting thing was, of those three things, it was none of those three things which was the most popular. Almost as a side effect of the process of putting this live, those radio shows were uploaded to iTunes as free podcasts. Nobody really thought about that and what the impact of that could be. It wasn't really a primary usage, but putting it into that social content channel has been the most important global impact of this show. 35 million downloads and counting later, we're at a point where millions of people around the world have come into contact with this amazing story for free, which is very important to us as part of the museum's advocacy role. Given a chance to experience that narrative and hear directly from Neil about the story of mankind. And I said, it's the unintentional things sometimes which have the biggest impact. I think the interesting thing is we're at a very interesting point now in the way that non-fiction narrative storytelling is starting to work in media markets. So I thought I'd talk a little bit about some of the interesting things that are happening out there in the world. Wait, one sec. So this is a time of kind of innovation in the non-fiction narrative space. A lot of the innovation that's been happening in the market for the last 4 or 5 years has been either around sport, fantastic high-value thing where you can do incredible things very quickly, build enormous audiences for it, or around fiction. Netflix, Amazon Prime, they're starting to become amazing commissioners of drama, of comedy, of children's programs. We're starting to see what's happening now, actually, is that non-fiction storytelling is starting to find its own space in this. This, I think, is the most amazing example that's happened in the last 6 months. So I don't know if Serial as a property has traveled here, but Serial is a story told in 12 podcasts where a journalist over a period of a year investigated the murder of a girl in America in early 2000s. It is in a classic piece of American storytelling that kind of unpicks the whole of American society, the different relationship between economics, between race, between how crimes are solved, between how teenagers behave in the media, all of those things, but in a podcast. Now, people don't think of podcasts as being a media that, again, has a great social impact. This show went from zero downloads to 5 million downloads a week in a week because it was really good. And because it did storytelling in a way that was impossible before but becomes possible now. So I thought we'd just watch a little video about it. Next one. We really need the sound for this bit, so we'll just hold on. Okay, try again.
EHS, when you had no control over when to watch or listen to your favourite programmes, Newsnight, of course. Well, that era is back for millions of listeners to a new radio show that releases just one episode every week. The success of Serial is astonishing. A weekly podcast, a very modern and traditional way of telling stories. needed. From This American Life and WBEZ Chicago, it's Serial. One story told week by week. I'm Sarah Koenig.
It's the number one podcast in America, it's the number one podcast in Australia, and it's the number two podcast in the UK. And yet, you feel as though there's a long way to go, as if the dam is about to burst and everyone will be listening to this and talking about it.
For the last year, I've spent every working day trying to figure out where a high school kid was for an hour after school one day in 1999.
An American journalist called it the Dickens of the podcast age, in the way that you're waiting chapter by chapter for the next edition to come out. It's in that wonderful phase at the moment where it's a cult and there are people having listening parties. There are obviously huge forums taking place around it.
Coming up this season on Syria.
I think that there are other people involved, but maybe he was set up. I think he was set up somehow.
Clearly could tell something wasn't going or it wasn't good. It was just strange behavior for anybody.
Okay, I think we can take over.
A campaign journalist saying that this man is innocent and I'm going to prove it to you. She just
did something. I think there's two amazing things to learn from Serial. One is that it doesn't resolve its narrative. We still don't know at the end of those 12 episodes whether Adnan Syed did murder his girlfriend or not. I think that's inspiration as we start to tell stories about the objects in our collection, because there isn't a definitive answer to what they mean. But actually what you've got is an incredible body of history around them and storytelling around them, unpicking that narrative in pieces, seeing how an object from 3,000 years ago can continue to inspire different stories and has acquired different meanings over time as countries have changed, as politics have changed, as religion have changed, is a great model for us all to learn from. I think the second part is about how media gets out into the world. Serial has been partly so popular because it's done the opposite of what Netflix have done as they've released new shows. As Netflix have released TV shows, they thought that releasing them all at once, the whole series all in one go, is the best way to do it. It may be if you're going to watch TV box sets. I watched a whole box set on the flight over here yesterday. It was a good way to consume a TV show that I hadn't seen before. But actually, sometimes scarcity matters. So Serial releasing every week and being religious, really about publicising when it's coming out, has been partly what's driven demand for it. It gives you that period of time where social media can really start to do that work. If you're doing storytelling that inspires communities and needs communities to respond to it, actually having a gap between those two things is really important because they've got time to build momentum. And then every Friday becomes a key point waiting for it to happen. In a way, that's a lesson from traditional television. Traditional television has always worked on the fact that it's Saturday night, it's 7 o'clock, here's America's Got Talent, or whatever that program happens to be. And actually doing that in some of the storytelling that you could do, I think, is an incredibly important and powerful part of that. I think this is another interesting one. So this is something that's only happening in the last 2 weeks. As I said, most of what's happening in the market for new types of content is happening in a space which is driven by fiction. So TV series with Kevin Spacey, things where you can put a famous actor in and then promote it heavily in advance, that's kind of easy stuff. The New Yorker Presents is the first example of non-fiction storytelling on Amazon Prime. So Amazon Prime is increasingly becoming, alongside Netflix, the primary streaming media channel, driven by subscription for people who actually just want their stuff from Amazon the next day. The New Yorker Presents is an attempt to tell stories by one of the world's most famous magazines, very highbrow, serious magazine. New York is not where you go for light entertainment. And for them to do a TV program, I think, is an incredibly bold and powerful step. And the interesting thing is, they're not doing it through traditional television. They're doing it through new types of television, through streaming channels, which are emerging and which will give people who are specialist audiences a chance. Things were really important for the moment in the museums. And when the iPhone was released in 2007, none of us really realized it. Again, what I believe has happened with the iPhone is it collapses the boundaries between the audience who visits the museum, who use iPhones and all other mobile phones as part of their experience in museums, whether we want them to or not, and the audience who will never visit, who are using our content on the web. That's the first time, and in the museum, British Museum, that's 275 years, the first time in those 275 years where the whole of that audience has come together in one place. It used to be our primary way of reaching out to the world was through books. But books are actually a very bad way of reaching millions and tens of millions of people. They don't. They reach thousands of people, sometimes tens of thousands of people. And the iPhone gives you a chance to find a device that people are using where all that content can come together. So what are we using mobile for? The first bit is starting with the simple bit, is the primary reason why people use our websites is to plan for their visit to the museum. Now that accounts for about 30% of our web traffic, so a huge amount of people use that. Now 30% of our total audience of 7 million people would suggest to you that you are at about 2.5 million people using it for visit planning. It's not true. It's half of that number, because 1.25 million people use the website twice to plan their visit to the museum. First of all, they look at it where they come from. So wherever they are in the world, we see a huge number of people who use the website for a short period of time on just the first few home pages to find out where the museum is. Actually, if you've been to London, the British Museum is remarkably, despite the fact it is right in the middle of London, it's not quite where you would happen to walk if you're a tourist. So they have to find out where it is. They have to find out then when is it open. Now, I can see by the fact that hundreds of people are standing outside the museum for about half an hour before it opens, that not everybody is going through this process. The museum opens at 10 o'clock every day, not 9 o'clock, and a lot of people don't seem to realise that. So they stand out in the cold, in the rain, in the snow, looking fed up, and they should look fed up. But they could have looked at the internet first, and it would have been much better. So the second time our 1.25 million people look at our website is when they're in London, because, of course, circumstances change. We had a very extreme example of this just a few weeks ago where Angela Merkel, who's been very interested in our Germany exhibition, was coming to London for the G20 summit, and she took David Cameron, British Prime Minister, to the British Museum for a meeting. Now, David Cameron has never visited a single museum in his time as British Prime Minister. I will make no comment on that front. But Angela Merkel is a very cultured woman who goes to museums a lot. And so she was coming to the museum. Now, clearly having two world leaders come to the museum, lots of security questions. Is it going to be open? Should we close the museum? We ran new security processes. We changed certain things. So, of course, that information is important and dynamic at that point. Tragically, that morning was the morning of the attacks in Paris. And so alongside that, not only did you have a kind of once-in-a-lifetime event of these two world leaders coming at the same time, you that had an incredibly complicated global scenario playing out. So it makes more important than ever that people can start their visit planning from simple information about what do they have to do when they get there. We had to institute instant new bag check procedures to get people into the building. And it's important that information is available to them. But more than that, I think you have to think about visit planning as kind of working out what you want the audience to do in relationship to you, and recognising that audience wants and needs different things from you. The British Museum, like all museums, is composed both of a vast number of tourists and a significant local audience. Now, those local audiences don't really want the same thing much of the time as your vast global audience. For many people, and we get 30% of all the tourists to the UK come to the British Museum when they're there, that will be their one and only time they'll ever come to the museum in their life. That's absolutely fine when we want to make sure they have a great time whilst they're there. So the important thing as we talk to that audience is to help them get what they need to have a good time in the museum. Now, we're a museum which only offers signage in English, which doesn't offer maps in other languages. So for us, a primary goal of that has to be converting that audience to using our paid multimedia guide services. That's the only context in which, if you were a Chinese visitor, you would be able to have a Chinese language experience in the museum. And so it's important to us that we take that web journey for them and make it easy for them to convert and buy that. Now, ultimately, I'm rebuilding all those products at the moment. Ultimately, I want them to be able to purchase that product from the internet as part of their experience for that. But I also want them to be able to reserve it so they can pick it up at the desk as they go. That's different from a London audience. A London audience needs different things from us. Now, our London audiences primarily come either because they're very regular visitors, members who come 3-4 times a week, who come to our educational events, who come to our lectures, or that they're kind of trying to come to our paid exhibitions. So we have to think about what that audience needs, and I think that that's about taking them into promoting our exhibitions much more strongly. Now, historically, we've just done that all through one website that talks about everything all at once. But actually, as we start to introduce new technologies and systems, personalizing and recognizing where that audience comes from and feeding them different content as part of it, we'll get to that. I think as the burden on museums generally to make more money and the opportunity through marketing to understand what audiences means that we'll be able to segment and target content to those audiences in stronger new ways. I think it's really what the audience wants from us. You know, a Chinese visitor who will come to the museum for 2 hours and then never come ever again doesn't really want to know about the deep depth of some of our research work. It's not really relevant to their experience. If they come back to the website after they leave, brilliant, give them that content, but don't give it to them the first time they're there. So taking this process seriously, thinking about that opportunity to convert and really thinking what your goals are for them, I just think is an incredibly important place to start. Next up is about in-museum experience. So for any of you who've been to the British Museum, it is very big. 7 acres in size, that's about 91 galleries that range over a period of about 7 acres. What that means is that people spend most of their time lost. I spend most of my time lost, and I work there. It's really hard to find your way from one way to the other. Now, the museum wasn't designed, if you were a user experience designer today, you wouldn't design a museum as it is. You walk in through gates that don't have the name of the museum on the outside. The museum doesn't have the name of the museum on the outside. You then walk into the Great Court, which contains a huge reading room in the center, which is closed. So you walk in a state of great confusion, and the museum's job has to be to help you in that process. Now, of course, we've introduced signage. Now, put this in context, we only introduced signage in about 2007. So before that, everyone was completely lost all the time. And you have to help people work out what they want. Now, again, the internet is coming to help us with this problem. Because as you start to see changes in technology, you'll start to see the ability for people to use normal technology out there on the web to help them through this. We began this process a couple of years ago with Google Maps. Google Maps has historically not gone inside buildings, but we worked on a process with them where they mapped the inside of the building. So that's taken from floor plans, it's accurate, it's to scale, and it shows the structure of how the museum works. Gives you, you can click on different floors, you can't see it on the image here, to show what's in it. Now that's useful for a start. Second layer of that is we're going to start a process of plotting key objects by GPS onto those maps. So that you can see that what everyone wants to know is, where is the Rosetta Stone? So the Rosetta Stone is basically where it says multimedia guides there. Not very helpfully labeled at the moment. And of course, you want to know that, so we can pinpoint that with exact accuracy onto a map that people actually use for where things are. The next layer of that comes next, because technologies have started to be introduced into the market that allow the kind of GPS tracking that you would use in your car every day to happen inside buildings. Apple are the pioneers of this. They have a system that was introduced in the last version of their operating system called indoor positioning. What's been amazing for me is I've worked with them on, they're using us as one of their trial partners for it, is the staircase that goes around the reading room that goes from ground floor to first floor, 53 stairs that I climb up and down with ever increasing heart rate every day. I can now see the little blue dot moving up those stairs with me. Now that's useful for me, because I still don't know where I'm going, but even more useful to a tourist who wanted to find the fact that the Rosetta Stone and the mummies, which are the two things everyone comes to see, are actually quite a long way away from each other. They're on completely different floors. So a lot of work at a lot of museums has gone into being kind of creating custom mapping. It's a nice thing, but it's very hard to sustain that. And also, ultimately, the technology that people use in their own lives is Google Maps. You know, so thinking how to use those technologies as part of your visitor experience, I just think is a very natural thing to do. If it means that you're using amazing technology that's out there, that you don't actually have to build anything complicated to do with, I think it's just helping you save money. And ultimately, it's going to help people have a better time in your museum. And everything I think we have to do as we do this digital work is just think how people have a better time in your museum. And I said, the technology companies are coming to help us. Then it's about thinking. So one piece of work around navigation experiences will be to create different products and services that just make sure people don't get lost and that they have a good time whilst they're there. The second then is about thinking about how you add to a sense of awe and wonder. Museums are amazing places if you understand what's in them. Not every audience who comes to the museum can understand what's in those museums. That's particularly so in a history-based museum where you're talking about very complex, beautiful historical objects like the Parthenon, but things that are quite hard to unpick unless you can read a very dense body of information around it. So we began a process about 2 years ago of starting to think what can happen in our galleries that introduces that sense of awe and wonder for children. I mean, put this in context, 250,000 British school children are brought to the British Museum every year. I don't want them to be bored whilst they get there. I want them to have a good time. And I want them to take something away that's meaningful for them. So working with a fantastic partner we have called Gamer, who make augmented reality game-based apps, we created a narrative-based experience for the Parthenon Gallery. We hope helps to explain the incredible story underneath them to an audience of 6 to 10-year-olds.
Thank you.
their advert is a little bit melodramatic. I apologize. But you can see the purpose of that is that if I was six, I would understand what that meant, and I don't understand what the Parthenon meant. And I think it's simply our responsibility as museums to help all of our audiences understand what can happen in this space. I think augmented reality is a particularly interesting technology for museums, simply because it hasn't worked in the way that it was supposed to work other places. It hasn't transformed the world as they promised us when augmented reality was introduced about 5 or 6 years ago. But in a museum where you're based around objects, augmented reality genuinely can transform because it can give you it can keep the physical relationship between person and object in place, which is so important to what a museum does, but give a role for mobile, which enables you to control the interpretive experience that happens in between it, and it can give it context and narrative and meaning. One of the things that's interesting for us as we start to introduce Wi-Fi, and I'll talk about what that can mean later, is that we can then therefore target users using our Wi-Fi with different apps in different locations. So this becomes the app that you would have in the gallery that contains the Parthenon. As we introduce similar apps or different kinds of apps in other galleries, we can introduce particular experiences for those galleries, marketed and merchandised in those galleries, that can bring those experiences alive. And that allows us to recognise that we all have very different audiences for very different bits. As we look at the journey of audiences for which we have large collections in the museum, we have fantastic native language speakers who will come from China to our Chinese galleries. We have a better collection of Chinese painting than any museum in China does, for various complicated historic reasons. Greek sculpture. We have a very significant part of the Parthenon, which again, people want to... So as we welcome tourists from around the world in, we can then start to offer specific language-based experiences, ultimately for the bits of the museum they care most about. And that just allows us to add depth to those experiences. And again, to think what our goals are for those audiences, both educative and commercial. So I'm going to bridge into talking about social media more generally. But I think ultimately, the biggest part of what we'll do within museum experience isn't about the things that we'll create ourselves. Simply put, as you look outside at the world of what people are using in media around you, people use incredibly sophisticated digital tools constantly, all the time, every day. That's what social media has given us. It's put powerful technology in the hands of millions and billions of people. Whether that's Instagram, whether that's Vine, whichever those channels are, what it's doing actually is enabling the audience to start creating, curating their own experience. Now, there's been many moves. I think all museums around the world have thought of this notion of enabling, of creating some kind of custom technology that allows people to curate their own museum of the world. It's certainly where the British Museum started out. I know other museums around the world have thought about this. Don't do it. It's too expensive and it's too complicated. People are curating their own museums of the world all the time in real time, but they're doing it on Instagram, they're doing it on Facebook. The shame and challenge at the moment for the museum sector is that very few museums participate in that process with them. It's just left to the audience to do that on their own. And that, in a way, I think forgets some of what museums' roles are, is our role is to be the interpreter between an object and the public. And if we don't participate in the way that people are participating with objects, we're simply losing our own role in the world, and we just become a room full of stuff. So I'm going to talk a bit more about the role of social media. Now, I think that selfies are the most important thing to have happened in the world in the last 10 years. And I'm going to demonstrate that. In fact, I'm going to take a selfie with you all now. We're going to do something on our website when we go home, so we're going to see if this works. You'll just bear with me for 2 seconds. Okay. If you've all just kind of shoved to the floor. So the point of inspiration for me with this guy Lester Wisbrod. Lester Wisbrod is an unknown celebrity photographer in Los Angeles who claimed that he invented the selfie. So back in 1981, he figured out that if he held a camera kind of like that, he would look good with celebrities. And he then spent the last 30 years taking photos of himself with fairly unfamous people, as far as I can understand. So you go from Hollywood legends on the left, like Charlton Heston, to two photos of himself with the guy from Will and Grace. Now, I'm not sure why the guy from Will and Grace is particularly important, but he seems to stand out for him. I think that museums have to deal with selfie culture, and if we don't, selfie culture is going to start treating us as wallpaper. this is starting to happen out there in the museum space. So the notion of museum selfies is something that started up over the last 2 years. I think the example on the left is awesome. She has nice hair. And this is a particular trend of people kind of making it look like the painting is taking its own self. That is very cool. A blogger who talks about this is asking the question, has art become wallpaper for selfies? I think it's more than that. Again, I think that the role that we play in relation to the public is helping them to interpret for themselves and being part sharing a role with them in helping them to understand what things are. Of course, this is silly stuff. But actually, it's an important part of sharing out into the universe what's inside our museums. So last week, now the fact that maybe I didn't know this, and if you didn't know this, then we all have a problem. Last Wednesday was International Museum Selfie Day. Some of us missed it. I missed it. We have to stop that problem, because what's that? If you look at the Twitter and Instagram feeds for this, there are a lot of photos being taken around the world on this. A few museums participated. The Wellcome Trust in London participated. About, as far as I can see, maybe 10, 20 other museums around the world participated. There are a lot more museums in the world than that. And I tell you one other thing is there are a lot more people in those museums taking selfies all the time. Every day I walk into the museum, I have to fight through hordes of tourists taking selfies of themselves in front of the museum. They have introduced selfie sticks, which should be banned, but they bring them, and they take photos of themselves with them. And it is, I would try to do a count of how many selfies I reckon are taken a day in the British Museum. 5,000? 10,000? 25,000 people come per day. If only 20% of them take one, that's 5,000 people. 5,000 photos. At the moment, that has no relationship to us as that content goes out inside the world. So we get no marketing benefit from it. It's not tagged in relationship to the British Museum. And again, we play no interpretive role in helping people to understand what it means. I think that can change, and I think that's one of the things that all of the museum sector should take as a responsibility for itself, because selfies aren't going to go away fast. They're an easy way for people to mark where they are in the world, and we have to start thinking how to change that. I'm going to talk more about kind of what we can do in social technology, because I think the simple things, the things we can do with Instagram, the things that we can do with Twitter, the things that help people to shape their own experience through us, can lead to much more complex and interesting forms of engagement. But I'd start with that Instagram world. What happens if every Friday you set a challenge for your audience to take a photo of themselves with one object over the weekend? What happens if you gave a prize for the best photograph of the person with that object? It starts to help you shape a role where you can explain that object's value at a point where people are actually interacting with it in a completely new way. And you can start intermediating in a process that helps people to understand things. Now again, the photo of the two women dancing with that object, again, it seems silly on the top, but actually some of the physical poses in some ancient Greek sculpture, for example, they really test the limits of human anatomy. And again, finding a context in which to talk about that, I think is really important. So it's finding a way to interpret at a point where it's really meaningful to people. Actually ask someone to interpret a statue which is virtually anatomically impossible. You know, ask someone to, you know, that's the things where you can find new ways to talk to audiences. This extends because the role of social technology is expanding all the time, and there are some incredible creative things taking place out there. So I thought I'd talk a little bit about one of the projects we started on in October last year. So I have a brilliant guy in my team who's everything anyone in a digital team should want. 23, so he knows this stuff. He lives it every day. Bright pink hair, talks too much, but he does say interesting things as well as the things he shouldn't say, and has no kind of inhibitions about going out and doing stuff. So he came to me and said, I had this idea that we should build the museum in Minecraft. And I said, well, okay, find out if it can work. I'm a good boss, so I don't have much time to deal with this stuff, so I just said, yeah, go ahead, see what happens. Now, I should have told our PR department we were going to do this, and I apologize to all corporate communications people, this is not best practice. But he's put a post on Reddit that says, the British Museum is thinking of building the museum in Minecraft. Does anybody want to help? Within 2 hours, we had 1,000 people who signed themselves up to help us. The next morning, we were on the BBC News. I did an interview in Wired magazine. It sounded like a brilliant strategic initiative. There was no strategy about it at all. It was just a fun thing to do. But we're going through a process now of turning a fun thing into something that's meaningful for the long term. So I thought you'd show you a video of what we've been doing.
Thank you.
So the important bit is the last line. Neil was fantastic in participating with that. He's brilliant at that stuff. So the important bit for that was actually that last line. The museum of the world for the world. That's the bit we say all the time, built by the world. See, what you've got there is a new model of participation with the museum. For the first time ever, actually, that participation wasn't about the objects in our collection. It was about the building itself. So actually getting a group of people to build it with you, showing that actually the roof is really difficult to build. It's really difficult to build in real life, even harder to build in Minecraft. But now it's about setting a program in place that makes this enduring, because the simple truth is millions and millions of teenagers and children around the world play Minecraft. 55 million unique users a month. It's an incredible volume of people. And what they want to do is build cool stuff and be given a context in which to do that. So what we're doing with them, and again, we're working with about 1,000 volunteers, is from about 2 weeks from now, we'll start, now we built it, which took a while. From about 2 weeks from now, we're starting a process where every month a new challenge comes up for a team to build a new gallery. So to take all the objects in those galleries and build them. See how hard it is to make the Parthenon. See how easy it is to make the Rosetta Stone. To make those things in Minecraft. What this is an incredibly kind of easy way to use an existing technology to help a community engage with you. Now again, a temptation is to start really building this stuff in 3D. You know, complex 3D modeling that takes weeks to do each object. None of us have either time or resource to do that. Of course, this isn't exactly a replica of the British Museum. It doesn't look exactly like it. But it looks enough like it for a big enough audience that it becomes meaningful. In some ways, and we all know that scarcity of financial resources is a challenge in the museum sector, the cost of this might be the most important thing. The whole cost of doing this, £1,000. For huge PR that gets on in multiple media around the world, for engaging thousands of people with the museum, for being able to talk in entirely new ways about what we're doing. No cost, because all we had to do was hire some servers, servers are cheap, to hire some slightly strange guys to help us build the stuff in the first place. Minecraft professional builders community is interesting. And to then actually just take the time and embrace the fact of doing it. What it does is this isn't transforming the whole museum as it is by building a new website. This shows and demonstrates the potential and power of what a museum could do. And I think that's an incredibly interesting way to work through it. So that leads into the second challenge I've taken on for what we can do with our stuff. A lot of the things that matter to me around the museum is kind of help letting the public do stuff so we don't have to. We have limited time, we have limited resources. What we don't have is a limitation on the depth of storytelling that we can do. So one of the areas that's strategically interesting around the digital space is what they call open data. Information sources that are put out into the world and which the world can use however it sees fit. Now the museum puts its collections data out in open data formats, so in RDF and other formats for getting that content out into the world. So working with a group in the UK called NESTA, National Endowment for Science, Technology and the Arts, and a thing called the Open Data Institute, which is run by Tim Berners-Lee, who created the internet, we've running a challenge with them for people to take our data and other data from the cultural sector in the UK and to see what interesting apps and other commercial products they can make from it. Now that's again is a process where we just have to stand back, make things available, facilitate process. We're running events in the museum, but not kind of just determining the outcome of what people want to do as they engage with us. And it's a challenge to say, let people make interesting things, see what those things is, and just open ourselves and culturally open ourselves enough to say that actually the world outside our door can have as great an insight into what the potential of the museum as we can. We can never think strategically enough. We can think interesting thoughts strategically, but other people will think more interesting thoughts than us, and we should just embrace their ability to do so. Third then, and a question I'm going to ask to you all is then around 3D scanning. So 3D scanning is one of those areas that museums around the world think about all the time. We know, of course, that we'd love to have 3D scans of all our objects, but 8 million objects ranging from tiny things this big to totem poles 65 foot high mean that actually the technology to do that is incredibly complicated. You might need scanners of 10 different sizes to go through that process. And simply put, taking a photo of something takes a minute. Taking a 3D scan of something takes anything up to 5 hours. Just divide times that by 8 million, and the notion that we'll ever have 3D scans of everything is kind of farcical. It's not going to happen in my lifetime. But actually, again, consumer technology is enabling interesting things in 3D scanning to happen faster than we can do them themselves. So in November last year, I had, again, in my slightly poor management sense, I allowed one of my designers to do an experiment. So he took an app, it's released for these phones, called 123D Catch, and went around the museum making 3D models of objects. Now, this app works. You take 30, 40 photos around an object, it then sends the data off into the cloud and makes a crazy 3D model of it. Brilliant, amazing technology, completely free app. Amazing thing to ever be available out there. We then talked to a website called Sketchfab, which is a platform for viewing and downloading of 3D objects, and said, well, let's put them up there and see what happens. Again, brilliant PR. Again, not quite communicated well enough to our corporate communications team. Front page of The Independent the next day, the British Museum is launching a 3D initiative. Again, a moment in time to just allow things to happen. Again, it's about starting off doing something new. So in April, I'm doing this properly, and our PR department does know about it this time, is that we're running an event at the British Museum where we're going to invite people to come into for the weekend to have a scanathon. So we'll take special objects out of storage, we'll kind of earmark particular things for people to go and do. And working with Sketchfab and Autodesk, who make the app that we're using, we're going to run that as a competition. Who makes the best thing? And find out, because again, this is a way to welcome the audience in to do something different with the museum. Generates content, generates PR, helps people to understand the museum in a different way. The thing that I think is interesting as a possibility about it is to not just make it a British Museum thing. And so my question to you all is, if any of the Singapore museums would like to participate in this process? Because again, it's a moment in time where we can adapt to an audience, we don't have to pay any money for it, we can all talk together about what we're doing. We're going to do this in partnership with some other museums in the UK, we might get some museums from the US in. It's an opportunity for, I said, the museum space to embrace what the audience can do in relationship to us. The world's media will come and talk about this stuff. So I said, if any of you like to participate, I'd love to work with you on it. And I said, we have a team developing this right now. And I think it would help change people's perception of what museums can be. And again, it creates interesting content. And that's in a way all we're trying to do in all the things that we do. The interesting thing for me was actually the question of, we made the models available to download via Creative Commons, so people are allowed to use them, but for non-commercial purposes. Is there really an audience for that? Do people have enough 3D printers to do this? And actually, yes, people are. You know, not millions, but thousands and tens of thousands of people are downloading these models. One of the things we're talking to the company that we're working with on this about is actually, with our partner museums, can we do a 3D print of one of our statues and put it in the front garden of someone else's museum, and can we take a 3D print of someone else's statue and put it in our front garden? You know, just an interesting moment to show the partnership relationships between museums and how our collections can be shared around the whole world. So again, I said, if anyone would like to work with us on that, I'd be delighted to work with you. So, that's some of the stuff we're doing. That's the core, mobile and social. The third part is really to then talking about data and kind of working out what it means and where it gets us to. So I'm going to start again by going backwards in time. Wi-Fi is really important for unlocking the potential of what museums can mean. So for those of you who don't know, Wi-Fi was inadvertently created in 1942 by the actress Hedy Lamarr. So, nobody watches Hedy Lamarr movies anymore. So Hedy Lamarr became famous in the 20s in Germany. She was basically the first person ever to be naked in a film. That's some claim to fame. She went to the Hollywood expecting great stardom, but Hollywood was quite disappointing for her. She had a strong German accent, doesn't really work in Hollywood movies. She wasn't Marlene Dietrich, so she didn't have that kind of charisma and personality. So she kind of gave up on Hollywood to become an inventor. And wartime was on, and she and her husband were thinking about things they could create, and her husband was doing more of the kind of science technology, she was doing the kind of wild, crazy ideas. And they came up with this idea for a secret communication system that was basically Wi-Fi 50 years before Wi-Fi was created. This diagram here is, I'm not going to try and explain it to you, but basically is an explanation of how Wi-Fi works 50 years before the event. Now, they filed a patent, patent 229-2387, which some 60 years later would make her a very rich woman. As Wi-Fi standards were being developed in the late 90s, they were called, before the Wi-Fi name was given by the Interbrand branding agency in 1999, Wi-Fi was called 808.11. And one of the Canadian corporations working very heavily on that realized actually we could get challenged on our patent for this, because this is the patent. And so they had to give her 49% stock holding in their corporation to enable this to go through. So this kind of changed the historic narrative about Hedy Lamarr. And so she went from being an actress that no one really remembered to becoming actually a great inventor. And she was inducted into the American Science Hall of Fame as a result of this process. So A, it shows that you never quite know what's going to happen in life. And B, I said, it shows that actually the narrative of Wi-Fi has been building for a long time, even before it started to matter. And now it really, really matters to the universe. It started to matter in the 1940s. Why does Wi-Fi and wireless technology really matter? It's simply that it enables us to gather data and information. That moment in time where we didn't really know what people did in our museums is one I think has to start passing as soon as possible. And Wi-Fi is the access point to that, so we can start to see what people do. It's not only about Wi-Fi. Actually, other technologies can come alongside that. Bluetooth and IP can start to be a phenomenal part of that. And I know you're